Here we're going to introduce the definitions of the big six trig functions. And before we do that, we want to make an observation. Let's do that now. Okay, so I have drawn two triangles here. So the first triangle is triangle AOB. Okay, so that's the first triangle. And the second triangle is the big triangle, COD. Do you see those two triangles? Now they share the common angle theta, and AB is parallel to CD. Now when that happens, so what you can see is that the two triangles have, all the angles are the same, right? Because for example, they both have this common angle, but I can also see that this angle right here for the small triangle is equal to that angle for the big triangle. And then likewise, this angle for the small triangle is equal to that angle. So both triangles have, well, they're all three angles are the same for both triangles, right? When that happens, we say that the two triangles, that is triangle AOB, is similar. Okay, that's the word we use in geometry, to triangle COD. And the way you can think about it is that, you know, these two triangles are basically like shrinky dink versions of one another. Like in other words, if you take AOB and you just scale it up, you get the triangle COD. Okay, so you have similar geometric figures. Now, the most important thing for us about two similar triangles, and this is really important in lots of applications of math, can be illustrated with the following observation. If you take the length AB, so let's write that like this, AB, and you divide it by the length AO. So imagine taking this length, whatever it is, and dividing it by that length. It turns out that's the same as if you take this length CD, which is the corresponding side to AB, right? So if you take CD and you divide it by CO, so this is equal to the length CD divided by CO, okay? And that's always true for similar triangles, that you can take the ratio of any two sides, and if you take the ratio of two corresponding sides in a similar triangle, those ratios are the same. Let's try another one. Like for example, AB divided by BO, so AB divided by BO. Do you see what that's going to be equal to? Well, that's going to be CD, for example, divided by DO, right? And let's try one more for fun. How about like, if I take AO and I divide it by BO, so AO and I divide it by BO, that's going to be, well, what are the corresponding sides for the bigger triangle? CO divided by DO. Okay, and you can always set up these little equations. Now, we in geometry, we acknowledge that with the following statement. We say this, corresponding sides of similar triangles, okay, are what we call in math proportional. Now that sounds kind of fancy. Let's read that again. Corresponding sides of similar triangles are proportional. But all you have to know is it basically means you can set up all these little equations like that. Okay? This is just a fancy way of telling you what we just observed, the little equations you can set up. Corresponding sides of similar triangles are proportional. Okay, now with that knowledge, let's go ahead and define the big six trig functions. Okay, so let's first start off with the definition for what we call sine. Now, sine is written in the following way, S-I-N. Now, it looks like sin, the word sin in English, but it's really this. It's really sine, S-I-N-E, okay? Now, sine of an angle. First of all, these two always go together. You never see just S-I-N by itself. There's always what we call the argument. So sine of the angle is defined in the following way. What you do is you first draw a circle of any radius, okay? The radius of the circle doesn't have to be 1, it can be 10 or 100 or a million, whatever size circle you want. Then you locate a coordinate system where the center of the coordinate system, or the origin of the coordinate system, is at the center of the circle, Okay? Then you graph the angle theta in standard position. So here's the initial side of the angle, and let's say my angle, let's say this was the terminal side. Let's go right to maybe there or so. Oops, try that again. Okay, so here's my angle, like so. That's the first thing you do, you graph your angle. Now, do you see where the terminal side of this angle, do you see where it intersects the circle that we drew? That point has coordinates in the coordinate system, coordinates x, y, okay? So now this length is the radius that we chose as well. So this was arbitrary. So I have for a given r, I have an x and a y. You're gonna need all three of these values for the six trig functions. Now sine of the angle turns out to just be this ratio. It's the y coordinate divided by r, the radius of the circle, okay? And that's it. You simply take the y coordinate and divide it by whatever radius you chose to use. Now it's important that you acknowledge this is a ratio, and what that's telling, the reason that's important is because that means it doesn't matter what size r you choose, because if you choose a bigger r, if you take y and divide it by r, but with a bigger triangle, you have a bigger y, but you also have a bigger r. And we know that the corresponding sides of similar triangles are proportional. So what's important about this is that it's the ratio, right? So you can choose whatever size r you want from the geometric observation we made a moment ago, okay? Sine of theta is always y over r. Now cosine of theta, cos of theta, is defined to be x over r, okay? And we call that, or we write that in the following way, cosine. Now we abbreviate that as cos, but it can be written out in its full name like this. Now you might say, huh, these names are very similar, right? Sine and cosine? Why are these named the way they are? That's a really good question, and we'll come back to that. But the basic idea is that you have this co in there, and co is short for complementary. And it turns out there's a close connection between sine of an angle and cosine of an angle, and it has to do with what we call complementary angles in geometry, that is angles that add to be 90 degrees. We'll come back to that a little later. All we have to know is that cosine of an angle is the x coordinate divided by the r, and then we have tangent of the angle, okay, and tangent is defined to be the y coordinate divided by the x coordinate, and we write that out as tangent. Okay, and likewise we have what's called cosecant, so that's written as CSC of an angle, and that's defined to be r over y. So this is an r. Let me fix that a little bit. So cosecant is r over y. Now that word's a little tricky, right? That was cosecant, so that's C-O-S-E-C-A-N-T. Cosecant, and we abbreviate it as CSC. Okay, the next one up is going to be secant of an angle, and that's going to be r divided by x, and that's written as SECANT, and we abbreviate that as SEC. And then finally, we have what's called cotangent of the angle, and that's abbreviated as COT theta. And that's equal to x divided by y. So cotangent of the angle, okay? And COT. Okay, now, this is it. These are the definitions. So what you do is you draw any size radius circle, or draw a circle of any radius, draw in your angle, figure out the coordinates x, y, and then you form these ratios, and you have figured out the value of your big six trig functions for that angle. Okay, let's go ahead and try that now. Let's use our definitions. Okay, that was a previous page. Let's try this one. Okay, find the exact values of the six trig functions of the angle theta, which is 4 pi over 3. Okay, so you start off with this picture here. You draw any size circle you want, okay? And you locate your angle, theta is equal to 4 pi over 3. Now, locating this angle is a little bit of an art, and here's what we're going to do. We're going to think about how this angle is related to integer multiples of pi, and by that I mean like negative pi, or 0, or pi, or 2 pi, or a 3 pi, for example, and so on, okay? So I'm thinking about how close this is to one of these angles. Well, when I look at 4 pi over 3, right, I say to myself, that's really close to 3 pi over 3. Now, why am I thinking about 3 pi over 3? Because I know that's 1 pi, and 1 pi is easy to think about where it's located graphically. Now, 4 pi over 3 isn't equal to 3 pi over 3. It's equal to 3 pi over 3, plus pi over 3, right? So this would be plus pi over 3. So what that tells me is that I know that 3 pi over 3, I know that's equal to just pi. And then I say to myself, okay, well, pi, right? That's 180 degrees, so that's going to be all the way. That's pi, right? But then I have to add to that pi over 3. Now I know pi over 3 is 60 degrees. So I go 180 and then plus pi over 3. Let's draw our angle in now. So it's going to be way down here, right? Right there. So, okay, now let's draw in our, drop the perpendicular at this stage. So I'm drawing this in like so. Now we've created a 90 degree angle, right? Now what's important when you are working with this, even though this is your angle, right? There's your angle 4 pi over 3. What's very important is to know what your reference angle is. And my reference angle right here is, well, pi over 3 or 60 degrees. That's 60 degrees. Let's write that in. So that's 60. Now, if this is 90 and that's 60, this must be 30. So I have a 30, 60, 90 triangle on my hands. Now, you remember how we said we could choose any radius we wanted? The radius that people often choose is a radius of 1. So if the radius is 1, that makes finding the coordinates of this point easy because I have a 30, 60, 90 triangle. And if you remember, when you have a 30, 60, 90 triangle and the hypotenuse is of length 1, the side opposite the 30 degree angle is length 1 half. So this length is 1 half. You have to be really careful. You might say, okay, that means x is 1 half. Not quite, because look, do you see how the x coordinate of this point is negative? That's because x is negative whenever we are in quadrants 2 or 3. So even though this length is 1 half, the x coordinate of this point is going to be negative 1 half. Okay? And likewise with the y coordinate, well, I know that this length right here, right, this is the square root of 3 over 2 because it's opposite 60 degrees where the hypotenuse is 1. So this length is root 3 over 2, but the y-coordinate of this point isn't just the length, right? Because the y-coordinate down here, right, all the y-coordinates are negative when you're in quadrants 3 or 4. So the coordinate of this point is going to be negative root 3 over 2. Okay, now you're halfway there because look what you've done. For the angle, right, the angle is all of this. The angle is all the way there, right? That's my angle, 4 pi over 3. For that angle, I identified my x, my y, and my r. And that means I can find all the trig values. So let's start off with sine. What is sine of 4 pi over 3? Well, as we said earlier, sine of an angle is always y divided by r. Okay, my y is negative root 3 over 2, right? Divided by my r, which is 1. So there's my first value, just negative root 3 over 2. Okay, let's go on to cosine. Cosine of 4 pi over 3. Well, that's equal to x divided by r. What's my x? It's negative 1 half. What's my r? That would be 1. So it's just negative 1 half divided by 1. And you can see you get negative 1 half. And now you also see why people often choose an r to be 1, right? Because it makes simplifying the fraction usually easy. But any r would work, right? The choice of 1 was arbitrary. Now, by the way, if you do choose an r of 1, you've chosen what's called a unit circle. So a unit circle is 1 where the r is equal to 1, okay? But you can choose any r you want. All right, How about next on our line list is going to be tangent of 4 pi over 3? Well, tangent of an angle is always y divided by x, right? So it's y divided by x. So it's going to be negative root 3 over 2 divided by negative 1 half. So the first thing I note is that it's a negative over a negative, which is a positive. Now, whenever you have one fraction divided by another, it's always the top fraction multiplied by the reciprocal of the bottom one. So it's going to be root 3 over 2 times the reciprocal of 1 half, which is 2 over 1. And the 2's cancel, and I get just the square root of 3. Let's go on to cotangent, or make that, I like to go on to cosecant next. So let's see, cosecant of 4 pi over 3. Well, cosecant is defined to be r over y. R is 1, and y is negative root 3 over 2, so it's 1 over negative root 3 over 2. And again, it's the top, right? The top fraction, 1 divided by the reciprocal of the denominator. Now, when you take the when you do that, you're just going to get 1 times the reciprocal of this, which is just the reciprocal of that. So it's just going to be negative 2 over the square root of 3. Now, we want to rationalize the denominator, so I'm going to multiply top and bottom by the square root of 3. And I'm going to get negative 2 square root of 3 over 3. That's going to be cosecant of 4 pi over 3. The next step is going to be secant. So it'll be secant of 4 pi over 3. And that's defined to be, well, that's r over x. So it's 1 divided by negative 1 half. So 1 divided by negative 1 half. And I can see that's going to be negative 2. And then finally, we're going to look for cotangent, right? So it's going to be cotangent of 4 pi over 3. And that, by definition, is x over y. So it's x over y. So it's going to be negative 1 half. Let's get some space here. Divided by negative root 3 over 2. Negative root 3 over 2. Whew, fit that in there. Okay, and a negative divided by a negative is a positive. So you take the top fraction, which is going to be 1 half, multiplied by the reciprocal of the bottom one. So it's going to be 2 over root 3. And now the 2's cancel. So I get 1 over root 3, but I want to rationalize the denominator. So top and bottom by the square root of 3. And I get, finally, the square root of 3 over 3. Okay, so this was a long problem, right? We had to find the six trig functions, the six trig values of the angle 4 pi over 3. Now, all you have to do, remember, is draw in your angle and choose any size radius you want. And for that radius, you have to find the corresponding coordinates, x and y. Okay, so we're going to work on finding trig values of different angles later on, and we'll also see that sometimes you do want to choose indeed an r with a different value of 1. Okay, so here I chose r to be 1, but you don't always have to do that, right? Sometimes it's actually advantageous to choose a different r. Okay, until next time.